Welcome, welcome, beloved of Christ, to Arbor Drive Community Church. We're excited to have you here today on this first day of the new year. It's just a privilege to be able to worship with you. If by some chance you're a guest today, I just invite you to check out our bulletin to find out what's going on in the church, to look at the insert in there also. It's called a Connect card. And if you want to hear from the church office, if you want to share anything or see what those options are on that Connect card, you're welcome to look that over, fill that out, and drop it in one of the offering boxes in the back, and we will get in touch with you after that. I have a few announcements this Sunday. As many of you know, next week, Sunday school will be starting back up, and we're starting 15 minutes earlier at 9 o'clock in the morning. And this is going to give us an increased fellowship time between Sunday school and church, another 15 minutes. So you'll have time to greet guests, catch up with some of your brothers and sisters in Christ that you haven't seen throughout the week. And also, we're going to have prayer before the service in this room right back here. And you're invited to join us in praying for God's work in our hearts. Also, the annual meeting will be coming up on January 15th at 6:30 in the evening, and we invite all members to come to hear about the vision of the church, to learn about what God is doing, and there's going to be childcare provided in the form of a nursery. So if you're a young family and you have some kids, feel free to come. It's important that you hear about what God's doing in the church, and that that you can see the vision being laid out as we seek the Lord together this new year. Additionally, on January 23rd, if you are a new attender to Arbor Drive Community Church, on January 23rd, right after church, there's going to be a new attenders lunch, and you'll get a chance to meet the pastors of the church there and get to know us a little better, and we're excited about that. I've always enjoyed getting to meet some of our new attenders there. If you have any questions, as always, you can go to arbordrive.org and learn more about the church, or check us out on Facebook. In a moment, Joe's going to give the call to worship as we corporately, as the body of Christ, enter into God's presence in song and prayer and to hear the word preached. But now let us go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you that we're able to be here as the body of Christ, that we have the privilege of serving before you in a new year, that Lord, we eagerly anticipate the consummation of the kingdom at the coming of Christ. We eagerly anticipate when this world is righted, but we have a privilege to walk before you in these times and to proclaim the gospel, to be a body of Christ reaching out to those who need to hear the truth. And I pray that you'll just use this service today, work in our hearts, and lead us and guide us as you would have us go. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Psalm 71 says, "It is you, O God, I worship. My mouth will tell of your righteous acts, of your deeds of salvation all the day, for their number is beyond my knowledge. With the mighty deeds of the Lord God, I will come. I will remind all of your righteousness, yours alone, O God. You have taught me, and I still proclaim your wondrous deeds. Your righteousness reaches the high heavens. You who have done great things, who is like you? It is you, O God, that I will worship." So let's stand together and let's do that this morning. Let's be reminded that it is Him that we have come to worship and to praise. Let's lift our voices, let's lift our hearts, and as the song says, as we lift up our hands, let's physically make an outward expression of worship to our God of surrender. So let's lift our hands and our voices, and let's worship our God together. Here we go. "And as we lift up our hands, and will you meet us here? And as we call on your name, and will you meet us here? We have come to this place, and to worship you, God of mercy and grace. It is you, it is you, we adore. It is you, praises are for. Only you, the heavens declare. It is you, it is you. Let's sing this first verse together in this song. Just the men. Ladies, I encourage you to read along and listen to your brothers sing. Men, sing out.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. A great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and bleeds for me. And my name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. No tongue can bid me thence depart.
Right, ladies, you sing the second verse. Men, let's follow along on the words and listen to our sisters sing.
When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, oh, would I look and see him there who made an end of all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free.
As he stands. It is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free.
Father, as we come here this morning to worship you, we're reminded by the fact that we're in a new year, that as was prayed before this service, that you were the same last year, you're the same this year, and you'll be the same next year and every year from now until the end of eternity. And so, Father, as we come together this morning to praise you, to worship you, we want to give honor to you and glory to you for the great power that you have manifested in the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Father, we confess together that we don't always trust the gospel like we should, but we pray that by your grace, by the work of your Spirit, we would have more confidence in the gospel, that we'd be unashamed of the gospel through seeing the glorious power that you demonstrate in this message. So, Father, would you help us to do that for your glory and for our good, in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead and please be seated. This morning, I invite you to take your Bibles and turn to Romans chapter 1. We're returning to Romans. Took a week off to deal with some different texts during Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. And so as we return to Romans, the first order of business is to review our new verse that we're working on. So we've memorized Romans 1, 16 and 17, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and then also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. And then last month, we memorized 18 and 19. And this month, we're going to memorize verse 20. And so verse 20 of Romans chapter 1 sort of dovetails into, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all unrighteousness and ungodliness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them, for God has shown it to them, so that they are, I'm not 100% on it. So God has shown it to them. And then in verse 20, says, for his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made, so that they are without excuse. So I invite you, as we work on this verse this month, to join me in reciting this. So this is Romans 1:20. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made, so they are without excuse. If you remember last time we were together in Romans, we were looking at the fact that Paul was not ashamed of the gospel. He was unashamed of the gospel, in fact. And we looked at that idea, that concept of shame, and what shame is, and how shame is brought on us, and how we can be ashamed of something. So we can be shamed for something by the world. In other words, we can have people around us that try to bring us shame, that try to put shame on us, that try to intimidate us or make us feel bad about something. And then there's the other thing, which is being ashamed. And being ashamed is an internal thing, whereas shame is something that's externally attempted to put on somebody. And we saw that Paul was not ashamed of the gospel, yet he was shamed for the gospel. In other words, Paul had in his life, in his ministry, a life that was characterized by people that did not know Christ trying to project shame on him for his message. So Paul would go around to these different places, and he would get stoned, he would get mocked, he would get beaten, he would have all of these terrible things happen to him, and these are all mechanisms of shame. You torture, you punish a thief because it's a shameful thing. And Christ was punished with sinful men who deserved that shame, yet he did not deserve that shame. And we looked at how Christ... In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, said, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising its shame. And we saw how when we want to deal with being ashamed, we look to joy and we look to Christ. And we talked a little bit about how this influences and impacts our lives. So especially for you younger people, if you were not here that week, I encourage you to go back and watch that with your parents. Because we talked about how a lot of the decisions that are made in your life come from external influences from your friends that tell you that you need to do something that the world says is cool and says is what the way that you need to live your life, and instead of pursuing Christ and instead of being content with what he says about you and how he has designed you to live, you succumb to that shame and you go and you pursue these other things. And what happens is, as a result of that, you get more shame. And the gospel takes away our shame and our guilt. And so this morning, as we continue in that line of thinking, what I want us to see is we can be unashamed of the gospel because it is powerful and it is effective. So the key to understanding this, so remember in Romans chapter 1:16, we said because, that's the reason he was eager to preach the gospel, because he was not ashamed of the gospel. And then we've got that word right here again. And that's the key to understanding our point today. The question naturally arises when you read the first part of verse 16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel. Well, why, Paul? Why are you not ashamed of the gospel? And he says, because it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. So what we're going to do this morning is we're going to handle from right here to right here. Actually, really, we're going to be focusing on this part right here. We're going to be focusing on the power of the gospel. And so the first point is that this is a powerful gospel. When we talk about the gospel, we're talking about the message of what Christ has done. We can think of it in a couple different terms. Like maybe you think of it in creation, fall, redemption. So we're created to be in fellowship with God. We fall and we are sinful and our fellowship with God is broken. But God redeems us by sending his son to die on our behalf, to take the punishment for our sins so that through trusting in him, we're now reconciled to God in right relationship. That's the most basic form of the gospel there. And all throughout scripture, there is a general theme of man's total an absolute inability to save himself. So we've talked about salvation before and how salvation is necessary because there's danger. And we're going to retouch on that next week as we look at another aspect of this. But the point that I want us to see right now is that all throughout Scripture, there's this theme that you can't save yourself. So take Job 9:30-31, for example. If I wash myself with snow and cleanse my hands with lye, yet you will plunge me into a pit and my own clothes will abhor me. Here's what he's saying. Lye is a key ingredient used in soap. So what he's saying is, if I take and I try to clean up my clothes and I try to wash up my hands and I try to present myself before you, I will still be cast into hell because I'm that wicked. I am incapable of cleaning myself up to be able to stand before a holy God. What about Romans 5:6? For while we were still helpless at the appointed moment, Christ died for the ungodly. I use the Holman Christian Standard Bible for this because it really captures this word right here. The essence of this is helpless. We are absolutely, totally, 100% helpless to save ourselves. The person that's trapped in a pit, right? In a deep, deep pit. They fall into a well. And they're treading water, and the sides of the well are slick, and they can try to claw themselves out of the well, and the only thing that happens is they slip back into the water and slip back into the water. They're totally, 100% incapable of getting out of that well on their own. They are helpless. They need someone to save them. And Romans 5:6 says, for while we were still helpless, we were helpless at that time, while we were helpless, while we were sinners, Christ came and died for the ungodly. Or Psalm 51:3 says, for I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Romans 7:24, Paul, in talking about his nature, he says, who shall deliver me from this body of flesh? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ. He's in need of a deliverance. So why, as we get into Romans 3, this is going to become abundantly clear. Romans 3 is perhaps the most scathing and explicit description of human nature and human corruption under sin. No one is righteous. No, not even one. Our mouths are open graves. No one seeks God. As we get into that, the whole foundation of the gospel is that you can't do this. You're incapable of doing this, and you need this to be done. And so all of Scripture talks about this theme of man's total and absolute inability to save himself. So why does Scripture talk about this, and why is it important to accept and embrace man's total inability to do anything to contribute to his salvation? Because this is a hard doctrine. Because we inherently like to think of ourselves as pretty good people. I'm a pretty decent person. I'm not that bad, am I? And then what do we start doing? We start start comparing. I saw some people mouthing it. You know how this works because you've done it, and I've done it. We start comparing ourselves to other people. Man, I'm not that bad. I mean, look at so-and-so. They're really screwed up. At least I'm not as bad as them. Right? So what do? We meander through life looking at other people all around us and comparing ourselves to these other people. Well, my marriage is better than so-and-so's and so-and-so's, so then it must be pretty good. I mean, it's not that bad. I mean, I've never killed anybody. And sure, I complain and I'm grouchy with people, but, you know, so-and-so over there, man, he's always grouchy with people. So I'm not that bad. And so we walk through life, we look at other people all around us, and we compare ourselves to those other people. But here's the problem with that. Do you see? I hope you're seeing what the issue with that is. If I compare myself to any of you, if you compare yourself to me or anybody else in this room, a sinner is comparing themselves to another sinner. A fallen person is comparing themselves to another fallen person. And the standard is not what other people do. The standard is not outperform somebody else. It's not like when you get up there, God looks at it, there's a sliding scale of goodness. And then he lines everybody up and he says, okay, look, here's Hitler and Mussolini, and then here's, like, you know, here's the people that murdered, and then let's put all the people that just thought about murder, you know, like man, I hate that person. Let's put them right here. And then let's put all the people. And so you've got the sliding scale in heaven where all the really bad people are over on this end and all the really good, relatively speaking, people are on this end. And then at some arbitrary point, God cuts it off. And he says, right here, all of you people go to heaven. All of you people go to hell. You were not good enough. Now, we would all agree that that's not how it works, right? Every single one of us would agree that. Yet, when you go through life comparing your goodness to other people's goodness, that's your theology. Your practice is communicating something to that effect. Like, that's how it happens when you die. When we were praying before the service back over there, Mark said something. As he was praying, he said, there's a lot of people that are placing their hope in different things in 2017. Lord, we're praying that they would place their hope in Jesus. You see, the standard is not somebody else. It's not you compared to somebody else. When you get up there and you stand before the judgment throne of God, there's not going to be a sliding scale. There's not going to be everybody lined up in order of relative goodness to relative badness. There's going to be one standard. One standard, and that is Jesus Christ. There's going to be one standard, and that is God's holiness and glory. His perfection. And every single person here, no matter how much you compare yourself to somebody that you think is worse off than you, is in a very bad position apart from Christ, because you and I, all, everyone here, fails to live up to that standard. You failed from the time you were a small little baby. So that's why this is important, to understand our inability to accomplish or contribute to salvation on our own. It's one of the darkest truths of Scripture, yet it serves a wonderful and high purpose, because it simultaneously humbles man and exalts and magnifies God's power in the gospel to save. So think about this. You and I are so bad that we can't save ourselves. And though we might compare ourselves to others, we stand condemned before a holy God based on his righteous standard. So any comparison that happens is more therapy for us than it is attaining any sort of standing before God. And one day we will die and we will stand before God. And this, understanding this here, is hard for people to get, because we like to think of ourselves better than we are. And yet it's not until you see yourself as you truly are that you really appreciate the gospel, that you really appreciate what God has done for you in sending his son, that you really appreciate the fact that God's power was at work in your life to save you. Because if you're really not that bad, salvation's just kind of like this last boost to get you up there. And that's not what it is. So this is incredibly important. We are powerless. We are helpless, according to the NASB. So left to himself, man cannot be saved. I want to highlight this just a little bit more. In Mark 10, 24 and 26, Christ has just dealt with the rich young ruler, right? And here's what it says. In verse 24, the disciple, he said, it's harder for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven, or it's very hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. And then the disciples, in verse 24, were amazed by his words. But Jesus said to them again, children, how difficult is it to enter the kingdom of God? Okay, that's salvation talk. Entering the kingdom of God is salvation talk. How difficult is it to be saved? Maybe is another way we could put it. It is easier for a camel to go through an eye of a needle than a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. Now, I know that some of the ladies in here are crafters and do sewing or stitching and needle things, needlework. Have you ever had that moment where you're like, you've got a very, very thin piece of string or yarn, fabric, whatever it is? See, this is not my gig. Spool of, yeah, there you go. So you just to get all the little hair follicles together, and you sort of aim. And you start pretty far out, and it's like tossing a football or something. You just got to get that through there. And you try to thread it, and you miss, and you miss. Okay. Think of a camel. This isn't... What? Are you kidding me, Jesus? What is this? And this is what they say in verse 26. And they were exceedingly astonished and said to him, then who can be saved? In other words, that's impossible, right? You can't put a camel through there. I can barely put a piece of string through an eye of a needle. Notice what Christ says. That before I go there, I like to highlight coffee cup verses that are taken out of context. This is a coffee cup verse. This is a mounted on your wall verse, right? This is a Philippians 4:13 type of verse. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Plaster it everywhere, baby. We've got the context now. The context is your and my salvation. What does he say? Verse 27, Jesus looked at them and said, with man, it is impossible, but not with God, for all things are possible. Did the weight of that hit you at all? Your salvation and my salvation left up to us is impossible. It is like putting a camel through the eye of a needle. It cannot be done. But not with God. Because with him, everything is possible, including your and my salvation. And that's the point. Our salvation, because of our wickedness, because of our depravity, was an amazing feat for God to accomplish. It was an amazing miracle that happened when you believed the gospel, when you were saved. It was no mere small event in your life. It was a miracle of catastrophic proportion because your sin was of such it was so pervasive, there it is, in your life. It was so consuming of your nature that it took God to accomplish your salvation. That's why this is important to understand. Hebrews 7:25 says, consequently, he is able to save to the utmost. To the utmost. I don't know what that means.
Yeah.
Anyway, he is able to save to the utmost those who draw near to God through him. Draw near to God through him. And he is always making intercessions for them. Or Isaiah 63:1 says, "Who is this who comes from Edom? Is in crimson garments from Beziah? He who is splendid in his apparel, marching in the greatness of his strength. It is I, speaking in righteousness, mighty to save." Now, real quick. We sing a song called Mighty to Save, right? Savior, you can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save, mighty to save. Now, how often do we sing that song and we don't let the power of salvation through the gospel really sink in? He is mighty to save. We are unmighty. We are incapable. God can accomplish this. You and I cannot. Does the weight of that ever settle on you? So, the first point is that this is a powerful gospel. The second point is this. It is a powerful gospel because God is powerful. So the gospel is powerful because God is powerful. It is God's power that is in the gospel. For I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God. It is God's power unto salvation to everyone who believes. So here are some of the, just to recap and go through some of the different aspects of God's power. He creates the world with his words. Hebrews 11:3. By faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. So God speaks, things come into existence. He creates with the word of his power. He leads forth hosts and calls them by his name. In Isaiah 40:26, lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. He who brings out their hosts by number, calling them all by name, by the greatness of his might. And because he is strong in power, not one is missing. Or what about Exodus 15:8? At the blast of your nostrils, the waters piled up, the floods stood up in a heap, and the deeps congealed in the hearts of the sea. So they're walking through in the Exodus. They're leaving Egypt, and what happens? The Israelites walk through on dry land because God is so powerful that he's able to separate the Red Sea for them. Daniel 4:35, all the inhabitants of earth are counted as nothing, and he does according to his will among the hosts of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none. So that might make you feel uncomfortable, right? Does that make you feel uncomfortable that God can do whatever he wants? He doesn't have to ask your permission. He does as he wills with both the hosts of heaven and the inhabitants of the earth, which is you and I and everything else in all of creation. He does as he wills. Does that make you uncomfortable? You have a problem with that? It's kind of, I don't know. What does he say? And none can stay his hand or say to him, what have you done? Remember when Job questions God? This is one of the most terrifying passages in all of the Bible. It's like God rears up and he says, who do you think you are? Where were you, Job? Why don't you tell me where you were when everything was created? Come on, big man, put on your britches. Let's talk. You want to question me? Let's go. What do you got? Why don't you tell me who goes to you for wisdom? No one can answer back to him, what have you done? He has absolute authority and power. And this power, this is the power of God, and yet these don't compare to the power of the gospel. The word that's used in Romans 1:16 is dunamis, and we get the word dynamite from it. The gospel contains God's dunamis, his power. So remember that there are Jews in this church that have a rich history in Israel. And this rich history that we have in the Old Testament is a history of God demonstrating his power in saving Israel's people. So why did God do all those things with Israel? What are some of the reasons that he gives? 2 Kings 17:36, "But you shall fear the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt with great power and with an outstretched arm. You shall bow yourselves to him, and to him shall you sacrifice." So God brought Israel out of Egypt as a demonstration of his power and might. Exodus 9:16, "But for this purpose I have raised you up." He's talking to Pharaoh. "For this purpose I have raised you up." This is God talking to Pharaoh. "That my name may be proclaimed in all the earth, and to show you my power." God raised Pharaoh up in order that two ends might be accomplished. He might demonstrate his power in mightily saving his covenant people, and that that his name would be proclaimed. And then what happens? A couple of books later in Joshua, the spies go into the city of Jericho, an impenetrable fortress, and they meet a prostitute named Rahab. And what does she say? "Look, I heard about what this God did. I heard about how the waters swallowed up the greatest army in all of the world. I heard of this God's power, and this is the right God. This is the true God. This is the only God, and I'm going to worship him." Psalm 106:8 says, "Yet he saved them for his name's sake." Now stop right there. We're not going to breeze over this one. Just let this sink in for a second. Just think about that for a second. Sometimes we just need to stop and think. "Yet he saved them," talking about Israel. Why? "For his name's sake, that he might make known his mighty power." What about Gideon? Remember Gideon? Gideon, the guy that was going to, he was the judge that was going to go and go up against the, I think it was the Philistines. And he had this, "Are you really calling me God?" "Yes." "Are you really calling me God?" "Yes." "All right. Get an army together. God, what does God say?" "It's too big." "Okay. Here's what I want you to do. Go ahead and separate them out this way." Goes and does it. Like half the people leave. "Yep. Still too big." Be Gideon at this point. Like, are you kidding me? We're going up against this massive army. Yep, still too big. Still too big. And he gets the number down to the point where you and I would be like, if we were in that army, we'd be like, "All right, well, everybody else sort of went home, so see you guys later. I'm not going to the war with this many people." Why did God do that? To show his power. To show he wins the victory for them, not them. To show he's mighty, he's powerful. So in Deuteronomy 8:16-17, he reminds Israel of their salvation has nothing to do with their own power and everything to do with his. Verse 16, "Who fed you in the wilderness with manna that your fathers did not know, that he might humble you and test you to do good in the end? Beware lest you say in your heart, 'My power and the might of my hand have gotten me this wealth.'" It's very applicable to us today. So ask two questions. First one is, do we recognize the great power required to save men? As I said before, salvation is impossible apart from God. So man was created to be in fellowship with God. Man fell, and the image of God in man has been tarnished by sin. We're no longer in fellowship with God. It is much easier to make something good out of nothing than it is to remake something good out of something evil. So lest you think that your salvation was just sort of this, this was a massive miracle that has happened in your life, where God has changed you from evil to a child. And it was at great personal cost to him. It took his son coming down. So the enemies of God, the men that were at war with God, the men that cannot save themselves and will not come to God on their own. John 3:19-20, we've talked about that. The light has come into the darkness, and people don't come to it because they hate the light. They love the darkness because in the light, their wickedness and their evil deeds are exposed. So think of all the ways that man tries to make up for his sin, yet all the while doing it out of a sinful nature that cannot help but sin. The nature needs to be changed. And so the more we understand our depravity and complete inability to accomplish our salvation or even come to him on our own for salvation, the more we will see the glory of God in the gospel, the more we will be enamored with God's power, and the more we will worship him, and the more we will be unashamed of the gospel to tell others. It's the gospel that made Paul unashamed of the gospel. It's the power of God in the gospel that made Paul unashamed of the gospel, because the gospel was bigger than other people mocking him. So the first one is, do we recognize God's power, or the great power required to save men? And the second question I have is, do we recognize this power to save is found exclusively in the gospel? For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation. What is the it? The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. Have you ever marveled that it's a message that saves us? That there's power in this message? All that needs to happen for the power of this message to be released is it has to be proclaimed. So therefore, whenever you and I share the gospel with others, we are instruments of God's power. You don't just go and share the gospel with somebody as a weak little person. You go as an ambassador of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and with his authority and in his power, you preach the powerful message that he has given you that is able and does save people. It doesn't require you to change it to make it more palatable. It transcends ethnic barriers. Think about this. The same message that saved you is the same message that saves people in the Amazon jungle. Same one. It's a powerful message. And the sad thing is that a lot of evangelicals no longer believe this. And it's evident by looking all around us. We try to clean up the gospel. We try to change the gospel. We try to fix it. There's a guy that's saying, look, you don't need to focus on what Scripture says. You just need to focus on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's all that matters. Well, you're losing the rest of the gospel. We try to attract people with things other than the gospel. We're silent about the gospel to our neighbors and friends and family. And here's the really sad one, that many claiming Christ don't even understand and maybe can't even articulate the gospel. And we're ashamed of the gospel in our silence because we don't believe that the gospel contains God's power for salvation and that that power is exclusively found in the gospel. So as a result, we get churches that are aimed at entertaining people. We get churches where the entire focus of the church is entertainment. It's not aimed at preaching the word. It's not aimed at glorifying Christ with God-exalting lyrics in the songs. It's not aimed at meaningful prayer together. It's aimed at entertaining you. Bought into the world system. And here's the thing. Whatever you get people with, you got to keep them with. When we were in Missouri, there was a church for Christmas. They had a helicopter pilot dressed as Santa Claus fly over the church where they were having an event and drop iPods out of the helicopter with little parachutes for all of the kids and families that they wanted to reach out to in the community. What are they saying? Jesus gives you an iPod. That's it. Whatever we win people with is what we must keep them with. If you try to win people with a gospel that's not the gospel, number one, you're not loving them. And number two, you're going to have to try to keep them with that. And it's not that message that has the power. What about moralism? We fall into this one. You know, I'm not that bad as moralism. You just need to just be a little bit better. Therapeutic sermons that are aimed at your self-esteem rather than your union with and unity with Christ. Doctrinally weak preaching and teaching that avoids the utter corruption of man by sin. Trying to attract people with gimmicks. Here's the deal. At Arbor Drive, we want every outreach, we want every service, we want everything we do to be aimed at one great goal: making much of Christ in the gospel, not making much of ourselves, not making much of others, but making much of Christ. And God has promised to work through his gospel, and if we lose the power of the gospel, we lose everything. And we lose the power of the gospel by changing it. So we don't need to be persuasive or have fancy, eloquent speech. Paul said when he went to the Corinthians, "When I came to you, brothers, I did not come proclaiming you to you the testimony of God with lofty speech or wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Christ Jesus and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and fear and much trembling, and my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in the demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God." Or one chapter earlier in 1 Corinthians 1:17, he says, "For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, and not with words of eloquent wisdom, lest the cross be emptied of its power." Can I suggest to you, parents, this is what your children need. More than anything, this is what our family ministry is seeking to provide for you and for your children. We're aiming to come alongside of you as you teach your kids the gospel and how it applies in their lives. We are not here to entertain your children. We are not here to provide an after-school program. We are not here to soothe some need for a religious experience as you raise them. We're here to teach them the gospel, to teach them about Jesus and the power that the gospel has in people's lives, the power to save, the power to keep, the power to transform. We are here to help you teach them the gospel and to help them learn how to apply the gospel in their lives for their joy and God's glory. That's the purpose of our family ministry. And maybe that annoys some of you because we should entertain your kids. At least that's what the world tells you. Your children need the gospel. I want people in my kids' lives that will preach the gospel to them and apply the gospel in their life as they go through situations. Not give them eloquent words of wisdom. Not give them 5 steps to success. Not give them 5 steps to getting over a breakup. Not to teach them, look, just don't have sex. Gospel has power. Last point, briefly. It's God's power and therefore God's glory. So we've seen that the gospel is powerful, and it's powerful because it contains God's power. We've seen that it must be this way because of the great power required to save men, and that is the power that is exclusively found in the gospel. I want to close with briefly asking, why is it done this way? And the answer is a Sunday school answer. For God's glory. We've all said it. I want to put a little bit of foundation under that. It's true. That's the right answer. The gospel is set up this way. It contains the power it does. It must be preached the way that it was given in Scripture so that all glory and all honor will go to God alone. So Habakkuk 2:14 says, for the earth, this is God's mission statement, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Isaiah 48:8-11. Have you not heard? Have you never known? From old, your ears have not been opened. For I knew that you would surely deal treacherously, and that from before your birth you were called a rebel. This is God speaking here. For my name's sake, I defer my anger. For my name's sake, I defer my anger. For the sake of my praise, I restrain it for you, that I may not cut you off. Behold, I have refined you, but not as silver. I have tried you in the furnace of affliction. For my own sake, for my own sake, I do it. For how should my name be profaned? My glory I will not give to another. God is unapologetically God-centered. He is unapologetically concerned with his glory above all else. And when you are unapologetically concerned with your glory above all else, these things come into conflict. And the gospel removes that conflict. So we rejoice in God being glorified in us because we are satisfied in him. Because of the reconciliation and relationship that we have with him, we pursue his glory above all else and not our own. And we can be comfortable with him saying, for my name's sake, I defer my anger. For the sake of my praise, I restrain it. Psalm 106:7-8, again with the Israelites. Why did he bring them out? For his name's sake. So because it is God's power that saves, he alone receives the glory. He overcomes our wickedness. He changes our heart. He displays his covenant love in saving a people for himself. His glory is displayed in salvation through his power working in the gospel to save us. And we receive joy from that. So why was Paul unashamed of the gospel? Because it's God's power to save. The power of the gospel was greater than anything else. Because when it contains God's power, it will not fail. Because it has reconciled us to God, and now we can live before him unashamed. Because though we might be ridiculed, and people might reject us, which again, for you younger people, I understand that is the biggest terror of your life right now. Go back and listen to the last sermon on Romans 1:16. Though we might be ridiculed and people might reject us, the gospel message is powerful to accomplish God's purpose and save his people. We don't change it and we don't remain silent about it because it's the power of God. Now I want everyone here, when we're done celebrating communion, to go home and think about this. Talk about this with your children and with your family and rejoice in this, because apart from God, we can do nothing. And though salvation is impossible for man, it is not impossible for God. Let's pray. Father, I thank you that in our salvation, the power is not in us. It's not in our decision. It's not in our intellect. I thank you that this gospel is so powerful that a small child who cannot understand complex ideas can believe and trust in Jesus Christ for their salvation and be saved just as effectively and decisively as a PhD who reasons through it and comes from writing a book against Christianity to being a follower of Christ. I thank you that this gospel is powerful, and it's not in our presentation, it's not in our delivery, it's in our faithfulness that power is unleashed. So Father, would you do that work in us? Would you give us that confidence so that we can be unashamed and approach our friends and share the pure, true gospel of Jesus Christ with them and see your power at work and be agents of your power at work that we might do that humbly, seeking your glory and your honor and your praise, which results in our joy. In Jesus' name, amen.
And no legacy survive unless the Lord does raise the house in vain. Its builders strive. And to you who boast tomorrow's gain, tell me, what is your life? The mist that vanishes at dawn, all glory be to Christ. And all glory be to Christ, our King. All glory be to Christ. His rule and reign will ever sing. All this year, may the glory be to Christ. God bless you this week. You go in peace.